A high-stakes summit between leaders of the Philippines, the U.S., and Japan is happening in Washington next week. Manila's envoy to Washington says defense and security will be high on the agenda as China ramps up aggression in the West Philippine Sea. Don Tagala reports.
Philippine Ambassador to the U.S. Jose Manuel Romualdez has reaffirmed Manila's position that it will continue to stand firm by its territorial claims in the West Philippine Sea. He spoke Wednesday U.S. time at a press briefing in Washington, D.C., ahead of the trilateral summit between U.S. President Joe Biden, Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr., and Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida at the White House on April 11. The high-stakes meeting is happening on the backdrop of heightened Chinese aggression in the West Philippine Sea, in which Beijing claims most of the areas.
We have made it clear that we will not give up any of our territories, but we continue to reach out and tell them that we are ready to sit down and talk seriously about how to resolve some of the issues involving the territorial claims.
The Philippine envoy to Washington says the agenda of the meeting will include defense and security cooperation, as well as addressing threats on maritime domain. Still on the West Philippine Sea, Romualdez says the Marcos Jr. administration will not recognize the supposed gentleman's agreement between former President Rodrigo Duterte and Chinese President Xi Jinping, as alleged by Duterte's erstwhile spokesman, Harry Roque.
Any kind of an agreement that does not jibe with our policy of making sure that our territory is well protected will obviously be not recognized. I think that that's already been made clear on many occasions.
Romualdez believes this summit will not only strengthen the alliance between Philippines, the U.S., and Japan, but will also help achieve their goals of improving their defense strategy. On the economic side, Romualdez says leaders of the three nations will work to increase cooperation on tech and energy, among others, and to ensure supply chain resilience. He also underscored the potential economic impact of this summit to the Philippine semiconductor industry.
We are expecting to have a large amount of the investments that are supposed to be coming into us. Some of that is also being moved from China.
As tensions between the Philippines and China continue in the waters, Romualdez is hoping that China will see reason at some point. But at the same time, he's also confident that the 1951 Mutual Defense Treaty between the U.S. and the Philippines will stand.
The MDT is something that we hope will never have to be invoked. But if in the event that any situation calls for our treaty ally like the United States, we will not hesitate to do so.
Romualdez also vows the Philippines will continue to encourage all other countries to press China to respect the rule of law and recognize the 2016 arbitral ruling that invalidated its sweeping claims in the waters. Don Tagala, ABS-CBN News, Washington, D.C.
The task force on the West Philippine Sea of the Philippine Coast Guard is conducting an information campaign to counter misinformation, disinformation, and false narratives over the disputed waters. Commodore Jay Tariela believes this initiative will clear up contradicting narratives, particularly those coming from trolls who seek to muddle the issue. Tariela and the Public Information Agency are holding workshops with information officers in the Visayas. The Coast Guard official also said they are also working with tech platforms to take down websites or social media pages responsible for spreading fake information on the West Philippine Sea.
A former Philippine Agriculture Secretary questioning the accuracy of the Philippine government's report on El Nino's total crop damage. Leonardo Montemayor, the chairman of the Federation of Free Farmers, says the total agricultural damage could be higher as he suspects significant underreporting at the Agriculture Department regarding the dry spell.
Then another indicator which I felt very uncomfortable with was that with respect to crop area damage, the report was 54,000 hectares were either partially or totally damaged because of El Nino. And yet, in the same report, the Philippine Crop Insurance Corporation for the entire country paid only a total of 10.2 million crop insurance worth of payments to 994 farmers. So can you imagine the risk that the report is 54,000 farmers in about the same number of hectares were either totally or partially damaged, and yet the PCIC paid only crop insurance to a little less than 1,000 farmers. That's about less than 2% of the entire area and that entire number of farmers that were affected by El Nino. So I think there is significant underreporting and probably even significant underperformance by some government agencies with respect to El Nino.